Sarah Champion for Absolute Radio. Delighted to be joined by the legendary Isle of Wight Festival promoter, Mr. John Giddings. How are you, sir?
Very well indeed, thank you. Thank you for having me.
I think the word legendary just sits really well with the Isle of Wight Festival for me. I mean, you know, I've been there many, many years now, and one thing I always say, it's the only festival, to my knowledge, that has been banned by Parliament, which makes it all the more rock and roll.
That's right. When there were 600,000 people there in 1970, they decided to bring in an Act of Parliament stop a gathering of over 5,000 people overnight. So it took 32 years to get it back on track. And they gave us the rights to redo it. So it's fantastic.
Now, you were there in the Hendrix year, I believe.
I was there. I was at school. I don't know how I persuaded my parents to let me go. And I just remember walking over the hill and see, it was like going to war, seeing this many people. But then to find all of these people that enjoyed the same music as you did, because before that, I just sat in my bedroom listening to these LPs, wondering what was out there. And to see Jimi Hendrix and The Doors live was incredible at that age. And then I decided there was nothing better I wanted to do because I was incapable of being a musician. So I thought, I want to be involved somehow with music.
Why were you incapable of being a musician? What was the main sort of obstacle for you? No real talent.
Lack of talent, really. But
it holds me back as well. So I have to ask you, because obviously it's such a kind of, must have been an incredible gig. What are your overriding memories of that gig? Obviously, we've heard since about the organisation left something to be desired, frankly, and obviously that's what got it banned by Parliament. Was the island just wrecked? I mean, what actually happened?
It was absolutely devastating.
Yeah.
I mean, it was torn apart because there are only 150,000 people live on the island now, and to see 600,000 people in one place, it was just like guerrilla warfare. People were sleeping in the hedgerows. They were buying everything. It was... People were sharing everything. It was a bonding experience. It was extraordinary to be able to talk to anybody you'd never met in your life because you all wanted to go to the same thing. It was like going on a religious pilgrimage.
Did you actually get to see much of Hendrix and The Doors?
Yeah, I saw the whole thing. And weirdly, audiences used to sit down. So when Hendrix played, I walked all the way down to the front and stood by the barrier and watched him.
Wow.
I was that close.
That's extraordinary.
Oh, it was, and I tell you who was the best, The Who, by far. They were wild. The Doors were interesting, but he'd just come off that thing in Florida for exposure. So I think he was a bit chilled out. But just to see that many groups that you loved in one place at one time was extraordinary.
And so how old were you at that Isle of Wight Festival?
I think I was 16, 17.
Okay. And clearly, you know, obviously you went on to establish a career as a music agent working with, I mean, real rock gods, really. Your list is quite impressive, from Stones to Iggy Pop, who you still manage now, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very lucky. I came in the year of punk, and I was living opposite a pub called the Nashville on the Cromwell Road, which is now called the Three Kings. I walked in there one night and there was a group on stage and the guy had a Pink Floyd t-shirt and he'd written "I hate" across the top and he's stubbing cigarettes out on himself and it was the Sex Pistols. I literally just walked in on them and I signed X-Ray Specs, the adverts, which led to the Ramones, Iggy Pop, and then David Bowie was playing with Iggy Pop. It was a fantastic time to come into the industry.
Didn't you see someone incredibly impressive in a small pub in Welwyn Garden City as well?
Oh, that's right. I went on the bus from school and went to the back room of the Cherry Tree, Welwyn Garden City, and it said above the door, "The New Yardbirds" in little letters, Led Zeppelin. And again, we were sitting on the floor and the group had to walk through us to get to the stage. Stage was about a foot high, I think, and Jimmy Page dropped his bottleneck as he was walking by and it fell up my flared jeans. And he bent down and said, "Can I have my bottleneck back?" So next day at school, I was the man. Jimmy Page spoke to me.
Yeah. So what have been the kind of the highlights of your career as a musical agent before we come back full circle to the Isle of Wight? What are the kind of memories that stand out for you the most?
Well, punk was fantastic because it allowed anybody to do anything. Anybody could get up on stage and play. I saw The Clash at the 100 Club, Susie and the Banshees forming. Then the second part of my career really was the early 80s with Paul Young, Tears for Fears, Howard Jones, Duran Duran, Alison Moy, and they all had platinum albums at the same time. So they gave us the ability to travel abroad, go to Japan and Australia, which we I mean, we're just making it up, really. We're just having a good time and being paid as, along the way. But then it started getting serious in the late 80s when David Bowie's agent in America sent me an email. I don't think it was an email. It must have been a fax.
It would have been back then, yeah.
Telex. Maybe it was a telex. And it said, can you book Wembley? So I sent him back the availabilities for Wembley Arena. And he actually meant Wembley Stadium. It was really embarrassing. So, Jesus. I booked David Bowie at the Wembley Stadium, and I went up there, and I remember standing there. My legs were shaking for 5 minutes. I thought, God, what have I done? I have absolutely no idea how to run a show this big. But then you settle down, and you think, oh, it's just a bigger gig, really. I remember Princess Diana came. She was backstage. It was great. The Glass Spider Tour.
So was that kind of when, like a light bulb in your head went off and you went, actually, there's something about this kind of organising big events that is sitting quite well with me. I can see my future path here.
There's nothing more enjoyable than seeing 50 to 70,000 people enjoying themselves in the open air and providing that entertainment for them and organising it. I've always wanted to organise things from being in the Scouts, you know, as troop leader in St Albans, and I just like putting people together and making things happen and sitting back and watching it happen. Because for artists, you have to make it comfortable for them. And then when they perform, they'll perform to the best of their ability.
So when, coming full circle back to the Isle of Wight, being sort of reinstated as a festival, what was it about it that made you want to get involved? Was it that sense of nostalgia and remembering, you know, being 15, 16 and feeling that for the first time?
Well, it didn't strike me until I got there for the meeting, because the Isle of Wight Council approached everybody in the music business to restart the festival, and nobody was interested because you could only get there by boat. And the truth is, I only went there for the day for a laugh. I thought it would be good to go on the ferry. But once I got there, I got the vibe, and I thought, hang on, I came here in 1970. I've been going to festivals all of my life. Wouldn't it be a great crack just to restart it and see what happened? And look what it's turned into.
Well, very genuinely, from my point of view, it's one of the best festivals there is for me. And actually, ironically, because you said, you know, people were a bit sort of reluctant to take it on because you have to get a boat. That's what makes it for me. Going over on the ferry, it gives it that sense of occasion, which, add to the fact that I used to go on my holidays to the Isle of Wight when I was a kid. So again, I sort of have that sense of nostalgia as well. But genuinely, that's kind of what makes it. It's such a big event. It gives it that sense of occasion.
Yeah, everybody says they went to the Isle of Wight as a kid on a bucket and spade holiday. And it took me about 2 or 3 years to work out that actually I was putting people on a floating pub to get there. Because there's a bar on the boat.
Yes.
You're not sitting in a traffic jam.
No.
And because the ferries are every half hour, it staggers the traffic into the site. So it's really easy and accessible. It's a holiday island. It's a microclimate. It's got the best climate in England. There's lots of things going for it. It's a civilised setup. You can walk into town and go and see Carisbrook Castle, Osborne House. The whole place is steeped in history, which I love.
Mm. And I have to say, I mean, very quickly, having established it in its second incarnation, if you like, you attracted some incredible headliners sort of from the get-go, really.
Well, I was very lucky that having been in the business for 30 years, I knew some of these people personally. And because of the heritage, that's what made them want to come and do it. You know, Paul McCartney turned me down until I reminded him that Jimi Hendrix, when he played his concert in London at the Savoy Theatre, opened up with Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. So I said to Paul, wouldn't it be good 40 years later to do a Jimi Hendrix song? And that's what made him come and play at the Isle of Wight.
Ah, oh, fantastic.
Jay-Z did a Jimi Hendrix song. They all love that part of it.
Yes.
It's famous. The heritage is famous.
And the statue meets you, of course, as you first land, as you dock into the Isle of Wight. So who has stood out for you over the years? I'm sure that's a question you're asked countless times. But amongst the incredible headliners, who has pleased you the most?
Jay-Z was incredible because I didn't think an audience could get wilder until Kanye West came on with him. And then it just went to a different level. The Stones, when they played 3 songs on their B stage in the middle of the field. Coldplay were classic because they played after Lou Reed, who played an hour of unrecognisable music, and they came on and they said, well, we don't know if he played it, so we will, and they did Perfect Day, which I thought was beautiful. The Foo Fighters were 11 out of 10. McCartney, Springsteen, I don't think we've had a bad headliner, not that I can think of.
No, and quite often this sort of, the other acts that you can see throughout the day, hold their own surprises. It's never ceased to amaze me how well the Proclaimers go down, as a for instance. They're just one of those festival bands, aren't they?
They're a crowd pleaser. If you put a band on at 5 o'clock in the afternoon when people are warming up for the evening, they want to sing along. They want Mike and the Mechanics, Simple Minds, Spandau Ballet. They want an hour of hits, which they can warm up to the evening performance. And it's programming. It's like putting a puzzle together where you don't want 10 acts of the same genre. Mm. You want people to move around the site and see different things. So you have a rock act on the main stage, so you have a dance act on in the big top. You don't want the same things competing against each other.
Is there anyone on the wish list, anyone that's sort of just evaded you over the years but you've got your eye on?
I want Blur to come. I want Oasis when they reform. I want Prince.
They reform? You sound very sure that that's going
to
happen.
They're bound to. Yeah, they've got to.
Well, I thought
they owe it to us.
Yeah, they do. They do. So let's talk about this year's headliners. We've got Biffy Clyro on the Friday night, who are a real favourite for me, especially live. I think they're an incredible band live, having seen them actually at the Isle of Wight Festival previously and others. They just know how to deliver.
Yeah, I saw them headline at Reading last year and I really thought they'd risen to the plate, and I thought they deserved to headline our Friday night. And then we got Calvin Harris after them.
Yes.
Who I saw at Coachella this year, who... It's unbelievable the way he can control an audience, one bloke. But the double bill, the juxtaposition, I find really interesting. So I think that's going to work well.
Saturday night, the Red Hot Chili Peppers come to the aisle for the first time.
Oh, took me 5 years to persuade them. That
Did
took
it.
A long, 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 long time. Lot of talk, lot of chat. But eventually, the gap in their schedule, they weren't going to do any gigs this year. So I went over and persuaded them to come and do it as a one-off, as a UK-Irish exclusive. And again, because of the heritage, they thought it would be good fun to do. They perceived it as a good laugh, a holiday.
And clearly you didn't need to persuade Kings of Leon. They've done it before.
Yes, they've been there before. They really enjoyed it. And they wanted to do the Sunday night before the fireworks. They wanted to play with the fireworks. But what happened last time with Bruce Springsteen was I said, you've got to get off at 5 to 11 because I've got the fireworks at 11. He said, sod that, I'll play through them. So he said, here are my fireworks. I thought, they're my fireworks. You've stolen my fireworks. Kings of Leon like the idea.
Brilliant. Well, as ever, we can't wait. I mean, I'm counting down the days now. It's the highlight of the summer for me. Is there anything else, anything up your sleeve that we can look forward to at the festival this year? Because I know there's always plenty going on besides the incredible lineup, which is always superb. So is there anything else we can look forward to?
We've got so many different entertainment areas now. I've finally lost count of how many stages we've got. It's over 10, I know that much. But there's the Intoxicated Tea Rooms, the Bohemian Woods, the Hot Tubs. There's a Hey Joe bar, which is the Jimi Hendrix bar, the Butlins Ballroom, which I talked about earlier. And there's a few surprises. It's wrong to tell people in advance.
Okay.
You should turn up and discover it for yourself.
We will. And a thoroughly good time will be had by all, as ever. Thank you so much, John Giddings.
Thank you very much indeed. Cheers.